So, welcome everyone. Very pleased to welcome you. I'm welcoming you on behalf of Vivian Schmidt and the Center for the Study of Europe. And we are most pleased to have José Eduardo Agualusa this evening in conversation with Professor Linda Haywood. This is a terrific moment to have you, Professor José Eduardo Agualusa. Has received numerous awards, the UK's Independent Foreign Fiction Prize in the UK for the Book of Chameleons. He has also been the winner of the 2008 Melville, no, that's Professor Linda Haywood for the Melville Hercules Award. But José Eduardo Agualusa is part of the, has been nominated for the Man Booker Prize, and so we are very excited about having you this evening. Professor Linda Haywood teaches in the African and African American Studies program and has received the 2008 Melville Hercules Award for the best book published in African Studies. This is an event that is part of a series of conversations on Europe and the future of Europe. And we are also very pleased to welcome the Council of Portugal. And so I will maybe let you speak, and I think everyone is really pleased to have you tonight.
Good evening. Thank you very much. I will be very, very brief. But first of all, I would like to thank you very much for this opportunity to be once more here at the Boston University, here at the Castle. That is really a very, very, very nice place to have this conference and these seminars and the opportunity to exchange some views and especially to listen to very interesting and right here, it's my privilege to have here José Eduardo Agualusa. I was a reader of his books and I never thought that some years later I would be and have the privilege to have it here and make this short presentation. But as I said, I just would like to thank the Boston University here in the name of Elizabeth Arim that we have collaborate a lot and we have a good cooperation with the Portuguese consulate already for a long time. I remember being here also with the European Studies and the Professor Vivian Schmidt in very different occasions with the European Secretary of State of European Affairs, then also when we were here leading the European consulates that are eight European consulates here also with Ambassador Sullivan, that is the EU chief of the EU delegation in Washington. Last year also, if I well remember, it was with the Portuguese writer Gonçalo M. Tavares also. And I know that José Eduardo Agualusa is also going tomorrow to Lowell, to UMass Lowell. We also have a very good cooperation there. There is a Portuguese center for Portuguese language and culture there, and I know that Elizabeth are also in touch with Frank Sousa, and so of course I will not make the presentation of José Eduardo Agualusa. He's here also to tell us about his work and his thoughts, and of course later on we'll be fortunate to exchange some views. Also to say thank you to the professor for the African studies. I have also lived in Africa for quite a long time. Also in the case of Angola when I was a child. And so I just would like to thank the Boston University, and for me it's really a great pleasure to be here. And I also with me at CAM, the coordinator for the Portuguese language and Portuguese studies in the US, that also works in the consulate and is the representative of our language institute, that is the Instituto Camões, João Rachinha. And so, with no further delays, it's really a pleasure. So, now the floor is all for the ones that really we are here to listen to you. Thank you very much once again.
Good afternoon. I'm Linda Haywood. I do African and African-American studies, and I'm a specialist on Angola. I'm really delighted to welcome Jose Eduardo Agualusa to Boston University on behalf of the Center for the Study of Europe and the African Studies Program. Jose Eduardo Agualusa Avdecunha was born in 1960 in Wambo, which is in central Angola, and is considered one of Angola's most important writers. He studied agronomy and forestry in Lisbon before starting his writing career as a poet. His novel, Creole, was awarded the Portuguese Grand Prize for Literature, and he recently received the UK's Independent Foreign Fiction Prize for the Book of Chameleons. His books have been translated into more than 25 languages. His most recent novel to be translated into English, A General Theory of Oblivion, from which he will read tonight, tells the story of Angola through Ludo, a woman who breaks herself into her apartment on the eve of Angolan independence. Published by Archipelago Books last year, the book is one of 13 finalists for the Man Booker International Prize, awarded annually on the basis of the single book, and one of 25 finalists for the Best Translated Book Award by 3% of 2015. Please join me in welcoming our speaker this afternoon, Jose Eduardo Agualusa, to Boston University.
So it's a pleasure to me to be with you this evening, and special with Linda, and because she speaks so well Portuguese, she can help me with my poor English if necessary. And okay, I will read some parts of this book in Portuguese. It's a story about a Portuguese lady that goes to live in Angola with her sister, but she ate everything. She's very racist, and when the independence, the war, just some months before the independence, the war begins, she was so afraid that she isolated herself in this house during 30 years. So I will read in Portuguese, and you can read that. Odete insistia para abandonar em Angola. O marido ciciava em resposta, palavras ríspidas. Elas podiam ir. Os colonos deviam embarcar. Ninguém os queria ali. Um ciclo se cumprira. Começava um tempo novo. Viesse sol ou temporal, nem a luz futura, nem os furacões por desatar, iluminariam ou fustigariam portugueses. O engenheiro ia se enfurecendo à medida que sussurrava. Podia enumerar durante horas os crimes cometidos contra os africanos, os erros, as injustiças, os despudores, até que a esposa desistia e se fechava a chorar no quarto dos hóspedes. Foi uma enorme surpresa quando chegou a casa, 2 dias antes da independência, e anunciou que na semana seguinte estariam em Lisboa. Odete abriu muito os olhos. Porquê? Orlando sentou-se numa das poltronas da sala de visitas. Arrancou a gravata, desabotoou a camisa e, por fim, num gesto estranho nele, descalçou os sapatos e pôs os pés na mesinha de apoio. Porque podemos. Agora podemos partir. Na noite seguinte, o casal saiu para mais uma festa de despedida. Ludo esperou por eles, lendo, tricotando, até às 2 da manhã. Foi-se deitar inquieta. Dormiu mal. Levantou-se às 7, vestiu um robe, chamou a irmã. Ninguém respondeu. Teve a certeza de que acontecera uma tragédia. Esperou mais 1 hora antes de procurar a agenda dos telefones. Ligou primeiro para Nos Nunes, o casal que organizara a festa na noite anterior. Atendeu um dos empregados. A família saíra para o aeroporto. O senhor engenheiro e a esposa haviam estado na festa, sim, mas por pouco tempo. Ele nunca viu o senhor engenheiro tão bem disposto. Ludo agradeceu e desligou. Voltou a abrir a agenda. Odete arriscara a tinta vermelha, Os nomes dos amigos que haviam abandonado Luanda restavam poucos. Só 3 atenderam e nenhum sabia de nada. Um deles, professor de matemática no Liceu Salvador Correia, prometeu telefonar a um polícia amigo. Ligaria mal conseguisse alguma informação. Passaram-se horas. Começou um tiroteio. Primeiro disparos isolados e depois o crepitar intenso de dezenas de armas automáticas. O telefone tocou. Um homem que lhe pareceu ainda jovem, com um sotaque lisboeta de boas famílias, perguntou se podia falar com a irmã da doutora Odete. O que aconteceu? Calma, minha senhora. Só queremos um milho. Um milho? A senhora sabe muito bem. Entregue-nos as pedras e dou-lhe a minha palavra de honra que a deixamos em paz. Nada lhe acontecerá, nem a si, nem à sua irmã. Se quiserem, regressam as duas à metrópole no próximo avião. O que fizeram ao Odete e ao meu cunhado? O velho portou-se de forma irresponsável. Há pessoas que confundem estupidez com coragem. Sou oficial do Exército Português. Não gosto que me tentem enganar. O que lhe fizeram? O que fizeram à minha irmã? Resta-nos pouco tempo. Isto pode resolver-se a bem ou a mal. Não sei o que pretende, juro, não sei. Quer voltar a ver a mana? Fique quietinha em casa, não tente avisar ninguém. Logo que a situação acalma um pouco, passaremos pelo seu apartamento para buscar as pedras. A senhora entrega-nos a encomenda e libertamos a doutora Odete. Disse isto e desligou. Fizera-se noite. Balas tracejantes riscavam o céu. Explosões sacudiam as vidraças. Fantasma esconderam-se atrás de um dos sofás. Gemia baixinho. Ludo sentiu uma tontura, uma agonia. Correu até à casa de banho e vomitou na retrete. Sentou-se no chão a tremer. Mal recuperou as forças, dirigiu-se ao escritório de Orlando, onde só entrava a cada 5 dias, para varrer o chão e limpar o pó. O engenheiro mostrava muito orgulho na escrivaninha, um móvel solene, frágil, que um antiquário português lhe vendera. A mulher tentou abrir a primeira gaveta. Não conseguiu. Foi buscar um martelo e partiu-a com 3 pancadas. Encontrou uma revista pornográfica, afastou-a, enojada, descobrindo debaixo dela um maço de notas de $100 e uma pistola. Segurou a arma com ambas as mãos, sentiu-lhe o peso, acariciou-a. Era com aquilo que os homens se matavam. Um instrumento denso, escuro, quase vivo. Revirou o apartamento, não encontrou nada. Finalmente, estendeu-se num dos sofás da sala de visitas e adormeceu. Despertou em sobressalto. O fantasma puxava-a pela saia, rosnava. Uma brisa vinda do mar erguia molemente as finas cortinas rendadas. Estrelas flutuavam no vazio. O silêncio ampliava a escuridão. Um frémito de vozes subia do corredor. Ludo levantou-se. Caminhou descalço até à porta de entrada e espreitou pelo olho mágico. Lá fora, junto aos elevadores, 3 homens discutiam em voz baixa. Um deles apontou para ela, para a porta, com um pé de cabra. Um cão, tenho a certeza, ouvi um cão ladrar. Como é, amiguito? Criticou um sujeito seco, minúsculo, vestido com um dólmen militar excessivamente largo e comprido. Não há aqui ninguém. Os colonos bazaram. Vá, arromba essa merda. Minguito avançou. Ludo recuou. Ouviu a pancada e, sem refletir, devolveu-a. Um soco brutal na madeira, que a deixou sem fôlego. Silêncio. Um grito. Quem está aí? Vão-se embora. Risos. A mesma voz. Ficou uma. Como é, mamã? Esqueceram-se de você? Vão-se embora. Abra a porta, mamã. A gente só quer o que nos pertence. Vocês nos roubaram durante 500 anos. Viemos buscar o que é nosso. Tenho uma arma. Ninguém entra. Senhora, fica só calma. Você nos dá joias, algum dinheiro, e a gente vai embora. Também temos mães, nós. Não, não vou abrir. Ok, minguito, arromba lá isso. Ludo correu ao escritório de Orlando. Agarrou na pistola, avançou, apontou para a porta de entrada e carregou no gatilho. Recordaria o momento do tiro, dia após dia, durante os 35 anos que se seguiram. O estrondo, o ligeiro salto da arma, a breve dor no pulso. Como teria sido a sua vida sem aquele instante? Ai, sangue, mamã, você me matou. Trinta, meu camba, você está ferido. Basem, basem. Tiros na rua, muito perto. Tiros atraem tiros. Solta-se uma bala no céu e logo dezenas de outras se juntarão a ela. Num país em estado de guerra, basta um estampido. O escape deficiente de um carro, um foguete, qualquer coisa. Ludo aproximou-se da porta. Viu o orifício aberto pela bala. Encostou o ouvido à madeira. Escutou o surdo arfar do ferido. Água, mamã, me ajuda. Não posso, não posso. Por favor, senhora, estou a morrer. A mulher abriu a porta, tremendo muito, sem largar a pistola. O assaltante estava sentado no chão, apoiado à parede. Não fosse a espessa barba, muito negra, e julgá-lo-ia uma criança. Rosto miúdo, suado, olhos grandes que a fitavam sem rancor. Tanto azar, tanto azar. Não vou ver a independência. Desculpe, foi sem querer. Água, tenho bué de sede. Ludo lançou um olhar assustado para o corredor. Entre, não posso deixar aqui. O homem arrastou-se para dentro, gemendo. A sombra dele continuou encostada à parede. Uma noite se desprendendo de outra. Ludo pisou aquela sombra com os pés nus e escorregou. Meu Deus, desculpa, avó, estou a sujar a casa. Ludo fechou a porta, trancou-a, dirigiu-se à cozinha, procurou água fresca na geladeira, encheu um copo e regressou à sala. O homem bebeu com sofreguidão. O que precisava mesmo era de um copito de ar fresco. Eu devia chamar um médico. Não vale a pena, me matavam igual. Canta uma canção, avó. Como? Canta. Canta para mim uma canção macia, tipo Suma Uma. Ludo pensou no pai, trauteando velhas modinhas cariocas para adormecer. Pousou a pistola no soalho, ajoelhou-se, agarrou entre as suas as minúsculas mãos do assaltante, aproximou a boca do ouvido dele e cantou. Cantou durante muito tempo. Mal a primeira luz acordou a casa, Ludo encheu-se de coragem, agarrou no morto ao colo com muito esforço, sem muito esforço, e levou-o para o terraço. Foi buscar uma pá. Abriu uma cova estreita num dos canteiros, entre rosas amarelas. Meses antes, Orlando começara a construir no terraço uma pequena piscina. A guerra interrompera as obras. Os operários haviam deixado sacos de cimento, areias, tijolos, encostados aos muros. A mulher arrastou algum do material para baixo. Destrancou a porta de entrada. Saiu. Começou a erguer uma parede no corredor, separando o apartamento do resto do prédio. Levou a manhã inteira nisso. Levou a tarde toda. Foi apenas quando a parede ficou pronta, após alisar o cimento, que sentiu a fome e sede. Sentou-se à mesa da cozinha, aqueceu uma sopa e comeu devagar. Deu um resto de frango assado ao cão. Agora somos só tu e eu. O animal veio lamber-lhe as mãos. O sangue secara junto à porta de entrada, formando uma mancha escura. Marcas de pés saíam dali a caminho da cozinha. Fantasma lambeu-as. Ludo afastou-o. Foi buscar um balde com água, sabão, uma escova e limpou tudo. Tomou um duche quente. Ao sair da banheira, o telefone tocou. Atendeu. As coisas complicaram-se. Não conseguimos passar ontem para apanhar o material. Iremos daqui a pouco. Ludo desligou sem responder. O telefone voltou a tocar. Sossegou um instante, mas mal a mulher deu costas. Retomou a gritaria, nervoso, a exigir atenção. O fantasma veio da cozinha. Pôs-se a correr em círculos, ladrando feroz a cada tinido. Subitamente saltou sobre a mesa, derrubando o aparelho. A queda foi violenta. Ludo sacudiu a caixa preta. Dentro dela, alguma coisa se soltara. Sorriu. Obrigado, fantasma. Acho que não nos aborrecerá mais. Lá fora, na noite convulsa, explodiam foguetes e morteiros. Carros buzinavam. Espreitando pela janela, a portuguesa viu a multidão avançando ao longo das ruas, enchendo as praças com uma euforia urgente e desesperada. Fechou-se no quarto. Estendeu-se na cama. Afundou o rosto na almofada. Tentou imaginar-se muito longe dali, na segurança da antiga casa em Aveiro, assistindo a filmes antigos na televisão, enquanto saboreava chá e trincava torradas. Não conseguiu. Agora vou ler mais um capítulo pequenininho. Chama-se A Substância do Medo. E é a Ludo falando. I read just a small chapter, it's the Ludo speaking. Sinto medo do que está para além das janelas, do ar que entra às golfadas e dos ruídos que traz. Receio os mosquitos, a miríade de insetos aos quais não sei dar nome. Sou estrangeira a tudo, como uma ave caída na correnteza de um rio. Não compreendo as línguas que me chegam lá de fora, que o rádio traz para dentro de casa. Não compreendo o que dizem, nem sequer quando parecem falar português, porque este português que falam já não é o meu. Até a luz me é estranha. Um excesso de luz, certas cores que não deveriam ocorrer num céu saudável. Estou mais próximo do meu cão do que das pessoas lá fora. Nos primeiros meses de isolamento, Ludo raramente dispensava a segurança do guarda-chuva para visitar o terraço. Mais tarde, passou a servir-se de uma comprida caixa de cartão, na qual recortara dois orifícios à altura dos olhos, para espreitar, e outros dois, de lado, mais abaixo, para libertar os braços. Assim equipada, podia trabalhar nos canteiros, plantando, colhendo, cortando as ervas daninhas. Vez por outra, debruçava-se sobre o terraço, estudando com rancor a cidade submersa. Quem olhasse para o prédio de um outro edifício com altura semelhante, veria um caixote movendo-se, debruçando-se, voltando a recolher-se. Nuvens cercavam a cidade como alforrecas. Aludo, lembravam alforrecas. As pessoas não veem nas nuvens o desenho que elas têm, que não é nenhum, ou que são todos, pois a cada momento se altera. Vêem aquilo que o seu coração anseia. Não vos agrada a palavra coração? Escolham outra, alma, inconsciente, fantasia, a queixarem melhor. Nenhuma será a palavra adequada. Ludo contemplava as nuvens e via alforrecas. Ganhar o hábito de falar sozinha, repetindo as mesmas palavras horas a fio. Gorjeio, pipilar, revoada, asa, adejar. Gorjeio, pipilar, revoada, asa, adejar. Gorjeio, pipilar, revoada, asa, adejar. Vocábulos bons que se desfaziam como chocolate no céu da boca e lhe traziam à memória imagens felizes. Acreditava que ao dizê-las, ao evocá-las, regressassem aves aos céus da Luanda. Há anos que não via pombos, gaivotas, nem sequer algum pequeno passarinho despardalado. À noite trazia morcegos, o voo dos morcegos, porém, nada tem a ver com o das aves. Os morcegos, como as alforrecas, são seres sem substância. Vê-se o morcego arriscar a sombra e não se pensa nele como algo feito de carne, de sangue, de ossos concretos, de febre e sentimentos. Formas esquivas, rápidos fantasmas entre os escombros. Estão ali, não estão mais. Ludo odiava morcegos. Os cães eram mais raros do que os pombos e os gatos mais raros do que os cães. Os gatos foram os primeiros a desaparecer. Os cães resistiram nas ruas da cidade durante alguns anos. Matilhas de cães de raça, galgos esgalgados, pesados mastins asmáticos, alegres dálmatas, nervosos perdigueiros e depois, durante mais 2 ou 3 anos, a improvável e deplorável mistura de tantos e tão nobres pedigrees. Ludo suspirou, sentou-se de frente para a janela. Dali apenas conseguia ver o céu, nuvens baixas, escuras e um resto de azul quase vencido pela escuridão. Lembrou-se de Che Guevara. Costumava vê-la deslizar pelas paredes, a correr pelos pátios e telhados, a procurar refúgio nos ramos mais altos da enorme mulemba. Vê-lo fazia-lhe bem. Eram seres próximos, ambos um equívoco, corpos estranhos no organismo exultante da cidade. As pessoas atiravam pedras ao macaco, outras lançavam-lhe fruta envenenada. O animal esquivava-se, cheirava a fruta e afastava-se com uma expressão de desgosto. Mudando ligeiramente de posição, Ludo podia contemplar as antenas parabólicas, dezenas, centenas, milhares delas, cobrindo os telhados dos prédios como fungos. Desde há muito tempo que as via voltadas para o norte, todas, exceto uma, antena rebelde. Outro erro. Costumava pensar que não morreria enquanto a antena se mantivesse de costas para as companheiras. Enquanto Che Guevara sobrevivesse, não morreria. Há mais 2 semanas, porém, que não avistava o macaco, e naquela madrugada, ao lançar um primeiro olhar sobre os telhados, dera com a antena voltada para o norte, como as restantes. Uma escuridão densa e rumorosa, feita um rio, derramou-se sobre as vidraças. Subitamente, um grande clarão iluminou tudo, e a mulher viu a própria sombra a ser atirada contra a parede. O trovão ribombou um segundo depois. Fechou os olhos. Se morresse ali, assim, naquele lúcido instante, enquanto lá fora o céu bailava, vitorioso e livre, isso seria bom. Decorriam décadas antes que alguém a encontrasse. Pensou em Aveiro e compreendeu que deixara de se sentir portuguesa. Não pertencia a lado nenhum. Lá onde nascera, fazia frio. Reviu as ruas estreitas, as pessoas caminhando de cabeça baixa, contra o vento e o enfado. Ninguém esperava. Entre 1997 e 1998, desapareceram nos céus de Angola 5 aviões, com um total de 23 tripulantes, originários da Bielorrússia, Rússia, Moldávia e Ucrânia. A 25 de maio de 2003, um Boeing 727, propriedade da American Airlines, desencaminhou-se do aeroporto de Luanda e nunca mais foi visto. O aparelho estava há 4 meses sem voar. Daniel Pichimol coleciona histórias de desaparecimentos em Angola. Todo tipo de desaparecimentos, embora prefira os aéreos. É sempre mais interessante ser arrebatado pelos céus, como Jesus Cristo ou sua mãe, do que engolido pela terra. Isto, claro, se não nos estivermos a servir de uma linguagem metafórica, pessoas ou objetos literalmente engolidos pela terra, como parece ter acontecido com o escritor francês Simon-Pierre Molambat, são, contudo, casos muito raros. O jornalista classifica os desaparecimentos recorrendo a uma escala de 10, de 0 a 10. Os 5 aviões desaparecidos nos céus de Angola, por exemplo, foram classificados por Benchimol como desaparecimentos de grau 8, o Boeing 727 como desaparecimento de grau 9, Pierre Molambat também. Molambat desembarcou em Luanda a 20 de abril de 2003, a convite da Aliança Francesa, para uma conferência sobre a vida e a obra de Leopoldo Sédar Senghor. Alto, distinto, sempre com um belíssimo chapéu de feltro, que usava levemente caído para o lado direito numa estudada indiferença, Pierre gostou de Luanda. Aquela era a primeira vez que visitava a África. O pai, professor de danças latinas, natural de Ponta Negra, falara-lhe do calor, da umidade, da ameaça das mulheres, mas não o preparara para aquele excesso de vida, o carrossel de emoções, o embriagante tropel de sons e de cheiros. Na segunda noite, logo após a palestra, o escritor aceitou o convite de Elisabela Montes, uma jovem estudante de arquitetura, para tomar um copo num dos mais elegantes bares da ilha. A terceira noite, atravessou a dançar mornas e coladeiras num quintal de cabo-verdianos, na Chicala, acompanhado por duas amigas de Elisabela. Na quarta noite, desapareceu. O dito cultural francês, que combinara almoçar com ele, foi procurá-lo ao Lodz, onde o haviam hospedado, um lugar muito bonito, perto da Barra do Coanza. Ninguém o vira. O telemóvel não respondia. No quarto, a cama permanecia por abrir, os lençóis esticados, um chocolate pousado na almofada. Daniel Benchimol soube do desaparecimento do escritor antes da polícia. Bastaram-lhe 2 telefonemas para ficar a conhecer, com larga soma de detalhes, onde e com quem Pierre passara as primeiras noites. Mais 2 chamadas e descobriu que o francês fora visto a sair às 5 da madrugada de uma discoteca no Quinaxis, frequentada por expatriados europeus, catorzinhas e poetas com mais sede do que inspiração. Nessa noite deslocou-se à discoteca. Homens gordos, suados, bebiam em silêncio. Outros, em mesas escuras, afagavam os joelhos nus de meninas muito novas. Uma das garotas chamou-lhe a atenção, porque trazia na cabeça um chapéu de feltro negro com uma fina tira vermelha. Ia para se dirigir a ela, quando um sujeito louro de cabelo comprido, apanhado num rabo de cavalo, a travou por um braço. A Queenie está comigo. Daniel sossegou. Tranquilo, só quero fazer-lhe uma pergunta. Não gostamos de jornalistas. Senhora jornalista, tem dias, amigo, mas sinto mais judeu. O outro largou, perplexo. Daniela cumprimentou Queenie. Boa noite. Queria apenas saber onde arranjou o chapéu. A garota sorriu. Um mulato francês que esteve aqui ontem. Ele o perdeu. Perdeu o chapéu? Ou, ao contrário, um mulato se perdeu. O chapéu me encontrou. Explicou que na noite anterior um grupo de meninos, desses que moram na rua, viram o francês sair da discoteca. Detiveram-se uns metros adiante nas traseiras de um prédio para urinar e então a terra engoliu. Só ficaram o chapéu. A terra engoliu? É o que estão dizendo, Cota. Podem ser areias movediças, pode ser feitiço, não sei. Os meninos puxaram o chapéu com um pau, eu comprei-lhes o chapéu, agora é meu. Daniel saiu da discoteca. 2 meninos viam televisão sentados no passeio, diante da montra de uma loja. O som da televisão não chegava ao exterior, de forma que os 2 improvisavam os diálogos dos sucessivos atores. O jornalista já vira aquele filme. Os novos diálogos, porém, transformavam por completo o enredo. Ficou alguns minutos divertido a assistir ao espetáculo. Aproveitou o intervalo para se dirigir aos garotos. Disseram-me que um sujeito, um francês, desapareceu aqui perto ontem à noite. Consta que foi engolido pela terra. Sim, confirmou uma das crianças. Essas coisas acontecem. Vocês viram? Não, mas Baiacu viu. Daniel interrogou outros meninos nos dias seguintes e todos conversavam sobre o triste fim de Pierre, como se o houvessem testemunhado. Depois, apertados, reconheciam não ter estado lá. O certo é que nunca mais ninguém viu o escritor francês. A polícia arquivou o caso. Na escala de Benchimol, há apenas um desaparecimento de grau 10. O próprio jornalista testemunhou esse incrível extravio. A 28 de abril de 1988, o Jornal de Angola, para o qual Daniel trabalhava, enviou na companhia de um fotógrafo, o famoso Kota Kodak, o KK, a uma pequena localidade chamada Nova Esperança, onde teriam sido assassinadas 25 mulheres suspeitas de feitiçaria. Os dois repórteres desembarcaram de um avião comercial no aeroporto do Uambo. O motorista aguardava-os para os conduzir a Nova Esperança. Uma vez lá, Daniel conversou com o Soba e vários populares. KK fez os retratos. Anoitecia quando regressaram ao Uambo. Deveriam ter retornado a Nova Esperança na manhã seguinte, no helicóptero da Força Aérea. O piloto, porém, mostrou-se incapaz de localizar a aldeia. Estranho, confessou inquieto, após duas horas a se ir andar pelos céus. Não existe nada nessas coordenadas. Lá embaixo só tem capim. Daniel irritou-se com a inépcia do jovem. Voltou a contratar um motorista que primeiro já havia conduzido. KK recusou-se a acompanhá-lo. Não há nada para fotografar. Não se fotografam ausências. Andaram às voltas no carro, revisitando as mesmas paisagens, como num sonho, durante o infinito tempo dos sonhos. Até que também o motorista confessou desconcerto. Estamos perdidos. Estamos? Quem se perdeu foi você. O homem encarou enraivecido, como se o achasse responsável pelo delírio do mundo. Esses caminhos estão, mas é muito bêbados. Dava grandes socos no volante. Acho que sofremos um acidente geográfico. Subitamente aconteceu uma curva e emergiram daquele erro, daquela ilusão, estonteados e trêmulos. Não encontraram Nova Esperança. Todavia, uma placa devolveu-os à estrada e esta ao ano. KK aguardava-o no hotel, braços cruzados sobre o peito magro, rosto fechado. Mais notícias, companheiro. Revelei os roubos e estão queimados. Só nos dão material de merda. Cada dia fica pior. No jornal, ninguém pareceu perturbado com a notícia de que Nova Esperança desaparecera. O chefe de redação, Marcelino Assunção da Boa Morte, soltou uma gargalhada. O Quimbo desapareceu? Neste país, tudo desaparece. Talvez o país inteiro esteja em vias de desaparecimento. Uma aldeia aqui, outra acolá. Quando dermos por isso, não existe nada. Em 2003, poucas semanas após o misterioso desaparecimento do escritor Pierre Molambá, ao qual os jornais angolanos deram certo destaque, Marcelino Assunção da Boa Morte chamou Daniel ao seu gabinete, estendeu-lhe um envelope azul. Tenho uma coisa para você que coleciona desaparecimentos. Leia isto. Veja se dá matéria.
Well, that's I actually had read the entire book and was wondering what parts you would select. And in a sense, I'm glad that you selected the parts that you read, because the first thing I wanted to ask you is that I was in Lisbon. When the retornados, or those who left Angola, in Ludo's case, you remained, but I was seeing in Lisbon, in Restauradores, all the, you know, I went out every day, and you can see the retornados, those who had come from Angola, gathering. And it was an amazing kind of experience for me, because I was getting to see a historical kind of a process. I had not gone to Angola yet. So what I got, in what information I got on Angola at the time were from the retornados. I had sat down with some and had cafe, galon, and so I wanted you to sort of, which world should I put myself in? Should I put myself into that world of the retornados in Lisbon? Because I have another world, I have another experience in Luanda, which I'm going to get to. So let's think about those in that first chapter that are having their parties and that are leaving. You know, this is the night of just getting out of here because of fear, because of the, you know, knowledge that something is not going to remain. This Luanda is not going to remain. So why did you place her in Lisbon, in Luanda, instead of Lisbon?
Okay. Well, first of all, because this history must be in Luanda, just could be in Luanda. But for me, this is a history about the end of colonialism and about colonialism itself. I mean, this old lady that stay in Angola is like uma órfã. Como se diz? Orphan. Orphan.
Orphan.
It's the same. Okay. Orphan of the Portuguese Empire. Mm-hmm. And at in the beginning, she isolated herself because she had this fear of the others, and she during 30 years she stayed completely isolated, mm-hmm. and at the end she saves herself just when she discovered that the other is equal to herself. Mm-hmm. So what for me this book is about xenophobia, mm-hmm. and the fear of others, mm-hmm. and how all of that is crazy, mm-hmm. is a crazy thing. And I think the Portuguese that goes to Portugal and to other parts of the world, it's completely different thing. I think some of them maybe could have the same destiny, mm-hmm. of Ludo, because some of them after go out, they discovered the other in Portugal. I mean, they approached the Africans that come also, because with this all these people that goes to Portugal after the independence or just before the independence, there was Portuguese, but there was also a lot of Angolans.
Yes.
And I think some of these Portuguese that goes after that, when they stay in Portugal, they approach the Africans. And
well, that's another point that I wanted to raise, because in Lisbon, what I saw were families who range from Portuguese metropolitan in terms of their race to in fact their mulatto kids and in fact to even their servant. And this kind of surprised me, because if you're leaving the in dread of your survival and you fear that other, you don't bring them to your heartland. But they were bringing them to their heartland. So I want to deconstruct that what I saw in mm-hmm. Lisbon. Who are these Portuguese, in fact?
Yeah.
Are they the ones that I studied, who in fact were really racist, mm-hmm. who exploited economically? I saw all of that in the yeah. books and the reports, the original reports I was reading from the Chapter de Post. But in Lisbon, I'm saying, oh. Here are these mixed families. Here are Portuguese who seem to get along yeah. with these Africans. So both groups were running away.
Yeah, it's all kinds of people. That's the colonization and decolonization are big process and complex process. And you have all kinds of people. A lot of black Angolans mm-hmm. also goes to Portugal, and because they feel Portuguese, mm-hmm. and so you have all these kind of people. And you have a lot of Angolans of European descendants that stay in Angola as Angolans. Mm-hmm. So you have all these. It's not like white and black. It's a very complex process. And but for me, this lady represents this kind of Portuguese, very racist. And she goes to Angola because she must go with her sister, but she really hates everything around. And at the end, she discovered that the other guys, the other people, are just like her. And she said first, she said, "I'm Portuguese," and then she says, "I'm not Portuguese, but I don't know what I am." Mm-hmm. And in the end of the book, she discovers she's Angolan also.
Yeah. Well, then let's go to Angola, Luanda, where I arrived in 1979. It was the same when I was reading your first chapter. I'm saying, oh my gosh, yes, I understand that. Yes, I had a God, a soldier of 16 years or so in front, guarding the apartment where I lived. And there were crazy people outside. In the night, their guns, going off, and it was fearful. I had never seen a gun in my life, and I was confronted by two young soldiers with guns as I was waiting to go into the where the body of Agostino Neto, the first president, was lying in state. So I know that fear, and I'm saying that's real to me because I was there. But I was also meeting on my job at the National Archives. They were just building the National Archives. You know, Portuguese communists who were as happy with the Russian, Italian, Cuban communist corporants, they were called. I was a corporant. I was the only American corporant, in Luanda. And I'm saying this is a confused world because here, why aren't the Portuguese who are here, like my colleague, fearful? And he was drinking the Portuguese who were there drank a lot of, they've never got malaria. I got it all the time, but they didn't get it. So I'm saying this is an upside down world. Yeah. I'm a descendant of Africa, and I should be feeling at home. Yeah. More than these Portuguese, but here these Portuguese, and they're like, wow, Luanda, this is us. Mm. So place Ludo in that world because I'm seeing another side of that Portuguese in the colony.
Yeah. But what's the question?
Oh, I said, I want you to place that Ludo in that contradictory world that I saw in 1979.
Well, I think the most funny thing is that all that complexity, it's never what you expect, and all times it's a surprise, and a big surprise included for Angolans. Mm-hmm. And the book is also the all the recent history of Angola. It's told in the book. I lived in this apartment. All the story is inside this apartment, and I lived there. And it was in the ancient times, in colonial times, it was a very rich and building. And then was occupied by very poor people. And after the end of the communism, and when Angola became capitalist again, the building became capitalized
capitalism
again. And so when I lived in this building, some apartments was occupied by rich people, very rich people, but some of them was occupied by very poor people with chickens and pigs and etc. And it was really crazy because you have all these realities in the same building.
Yes.
And for me, it's very interesting that how you can see all a country and all a place, a town, in just one building. It's crazy.
In fact,
and a lot of things that people think it. You know that it was Angola.
Yeah.
People think it's a kind of magic realism. It's not.
No.
It's just the reality.
Yes.
If you buy the reality, you buy the magic. It's same pack in Angola. It's same thing. It's you can't talk about the reality in Angola without that.
Yes.
But for me, more than the magic thing is the absurd, the presence of the absurd inside all society.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you're exactly right, because I arrived in Luanda and I'm saying it's September, it's still warm and so on, and so I'm in the Caribbean. I'm seeing palm trees, I'm seeing the water. Wow, I'm at home.
And then the Cubans also seem to be saying.
But what is interesting is that contradiction that you said, that this alternate universe.
Yeah.
Because the next thing I knew, within 4 weeks of arrival, I had gotten some Makakinja, stuck in between my toes. That had to be taken out because my feet my fingers or my toes would be rotten off. And I was just scared because I said, I'm in a city. I shouldn't be getting things that you get on a farm. But I was seeing those goats and those, but it didn't occur to me to, in fact, not go out without, you know, my slippers to protect my feet, because this is a city. And that contradiction, I know.
Well, I grew up in another town, in second town in Angola, it's one, and it's much more surrounded by the jungle and land. And all my childhood, I remember to be awake by the ants that come inside the house, thousands and thousands of these big red ants, you know, that eat everything.
Oh, yes.
Yes. And things like that. And for us, it's usual. It's
normal.
It's normal.
Yes. Well, going to Wambo, because in fact I went to Angola to study the Central Highlands.
Okay.
And Wambo was going to be the place that they promised me that I would go.
Okay.
During my year of
Auburn.
I never ended up in Wambo. It was too dangerous. The you know, UNITA was there. I flew over Wambo to get to Mozambique. Yes.
Okay.
So that I could teach a 10-day course in African history from a Marxist perspective. That was my one of the things I did. So I wanted to, again, you know, get to Wambo and say that Wambo that I was reading about from missionary. There were missionaries from the American Board, missionaries for foreign lands, who in fact came in 1880 to your Wambo. Wambo was Wambo, it wasn't Nova Lisboa. Nova Esperanza wasn't theirs yet, so that's the colonial. So, and I'm saying, can you kind of give me that world of Wambo that you brought it? Because from what I was reading,
it's a very different place.
Yes.
Because you have Luanda. Luanda is a very old town. You know, I think it's oldest than any American places. And it's one of the, I think it's the oldest town in Western Africa. But Wambo, it's a new one.
Yes.
It's a new place. And it was built as Wambo, not as Nova Lisboa. Just changed the name a little bit after, but first name is Wambo. So recovered the name after independence.
No, it was Nova Lisboa.
No, it was
the first day when the city was built. It was going to be New Lisbon, and they were going they were going to build. They were going to use that area.
At first, the guy that built the town, it was a Portuguese general, Tormach, give the name of Wambo. It was the name of a king.
Yes.
And then somebody changed the name. And the Norton Match, this Portuguese, wrote a letter in a newspaper, a Portuguese newspaper, protesting against that. And so, when I was born, it was Nova Lisboa, but for me it was one all time. Anyway, but it was a very special place because it was a very European place.
It was a planned city.
It was a planned city. I used to say that I hear the lions when I at night, and it's true, but because the zoo, it was the next it was very cold. But I can hear the lions, it's true. But anyway, it's in front of my house, there was nothing, just nothing, it's just jungle. My house is in the end of the place. That's kind of this kind of town. You go at suddenly the town is over, and it was not.
I see that you didn't mention anything about the transport. You did mention the taxi, but you know the sort of transport. Wambo, to get to Wambo, during the colonial period, you could take the Benguela Railroad. And that was destroyed. And I wonder if that destruction of Wambo, when you go back to look for this area, that it's not, you know, what was your purpose in sort of placing, you know, the sort of that little village or so, you know, destroyed.
Well, I'm not sure if I understand.
Esperanza.
You know, as a journalist, I was a journalist during the war time.
Okay.
And I remember one day I get a plane to go to Malange.
Okay.
Malange is a big place. It's
not
a small town. Yeah. It's a big town. And we fly, it was a little airplane, okay? And we fly during 2 hours and then another hour. And then the pilot said, I can't find the place. And we go back to Luanda because he can't find the place. And, and that's why I had this idea of Nova Esperança, because he couldn't find the place. And the airplane that disappeared, it's a very true story. Yes. It's an American plane, big American plane, that disappeared from the airport in Luanda, and nobody knows why, until now. I'm writing a novel now, and I recover this character, this journalist, Benchimol. It's my main character in my new novel. And he is working on this history of the airplane that disappeared. Nobody knows. It disappeared with an American pilot, and the Congolese mechanic.
Yes.
And nobody can explain how a big airplane just disappeared, just vanished. But it's true. It looks like magic, really, but it's Angola.
No, it's all fascinating because as we went from Luanda to Melange, I was looking for those villages and those Portuguese settlements that I'd been reading about in the documents, and they were not there. There was a bush, or you know,
some really disappeared. Yes. There's a case in the coast. I never was there. I want very much. Now they made a movie about that place. And the Portuguese writer wrote a book, Baía dos Tigres. Place, Baía dos Tigres, it was a fishing village that just disappeared after the independence. The sand come and take everything. Now it's a kind of ghost.
Yes.
People say it's wonderful, but I never.
So I want to open up our conversation to our audience, and if you, I'm sure many of you have, you know, queries or elaborations, so we can,
I can start with the question, and then I'll pass them to the next person. So since this event is called Lusophone Voices, I'm actually curious about your connections to as an Angolan writer to the other parts of the Lusophone world. I know that you live in Lisbon, at least that's where you flew from, but I also know that you spent time in Brazil. So could you say something about your connections to Portugal while you were growing up in Angola, and then maybe how you came to live Brazil, and where you feel yourself now to be at home?
I think I'm at home where there's people that I love and loves me, you know. People are the essential, it's not the place. People are the most important thing. So where are my kids? I have 2 kids. I have a little daughter and a boy. And the little daughter lives in Luanda, in Angola. But the older boy is living in UK, in Brighton. So there's where they are, there's my place. It's, you know, it's like that. It's not. So if I go to Rio in Brazil, there's a lot of people that I love that, so I feel at home. But if I go to Cabo Verde also, there's a lot of people that I love there, and I love the country, and I can understand everything, so I feel at home also. And in Mozambique also, I feel at home, really. So, but that sometimes I can't feel at home at Angola, you know, or at Portugal, in Lisbon, because I feel at home where there's people that I love and I understand, and I can understand, and I can speak the same language. And the same language is not just to speak Portuguese, you know. It's much more than this.
Yes?
But as a writer also, maybe it's important to say that. As a writer, I work with Portuguese, and my Portuguese is the global Portuguese. I don't want to stay linked just to a kind of Portuguese, to an Angolan Portuguese, or the Portuguese Portuguese, or the Brazilian Portuguese. I use all of this global Portuguese. I try to use all of that Portuguese, global Portuguese, in my books, you know. And that's my literary project, really. Because I think the Portuguese language is incredibly rich, because it's languages so spread around and take from the other languages and the other cultures, take a lot of that places also.
Questions or comments or yes?
Maybe I can say other thing. When you talk before about the retornados, these people that goes to Portugal, and you was so surprised because they are mixed family, right, etc. You must remember all times that Portugal also is a very African country since the beginning, because the Africans stay in Portugal for 8 centuries, or not in Portugal but in territory that. That become Portugal.
Yes.
With the Arabs was African people that come from what is now Morocco,
mm-hmm.
and they stay in Portugal for 80 centuries.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's a lot of time. And then the Portuguese go around and take the Africans. Also, you had also black Africans in Portugal, black slaves, and all the south of Portugal was colonized by these people. Until now, you have people, you have families in the south of Portugal that have African names,
yes,
that have Bantu African names.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a lot of words in Portuguese that come from Bantu language, and even the Portuguese don't know,
mm-hmm.
because they really don't know. For instance, minhoca.
Mm-hmm.
Minhoca comes from nhoca, that and a lot of different Bantu languages, as Kimbundu, Kikongo, etc. It means snake,
mm-hmm.
you know. But there's a lot of different African words that are in the Portuguese
mm-hmm.
for centuries. It's not nothing new. Now there's also a lot of words, African words that are integrated in Portuguese because all the power of the Angolan music in Portugal, etc. But there are also very ancient words.
Yeah. But I do think that over the years that I've been going to Portugal from 1977 until today, that what I've seen with the Portugal being part of the European Union, that many segments of Portuguese society are more comfortable in the Union, even though because of the wealth from oil in Angola, that there's this interesting sort of relationship, which is strengthened, where some Portuguese government do not criticize certain decisions of the Angolan government until today. So that's very contradictory.
It is. That's true. Now the large part of the press, the Portuguese press, is in the hands of Angolans.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And so that's why this press doesn't criticize the Angolan government.
Mm. What do the ordinary Portuguese think about that relationship between not only the press, really the government as well, the Portuguese government?
I think there are different opinions. I think a lot of people just have a threat of the Angolan power.
Mm-hmm.
And because of all these Portuguese that are living in Angola also, because there's a big Portuguese community in Angola. I think that's very stupid, because you must have relations between countries. You must think on people. It's an error to think on money and business, immediate business. But it's like that. The fact is that there's a lot of newspapers in Angola, in Portugal, that are not critics against the Angola government, because they are paid by Angolans. And companies and banks and everything.
I hesitate to even ask a question, because I like the way the conversation is going. It's a real conversation. I was wondering, I mean, you have very few details in your in the writing. Sometimes it's very spare, and then one or two details. And I was wondering if you could elaborate on the Cape Verdean and the Cape Verdean community and the role it plays as maybe as part of migration within Angola. I'm thinking of some writers, in, for instance, in Senegal, also mentioning the Cape Verdean community, and so maybe if you could.
Well, the Cape Verdean community in Angola was very, very important. But they are completely Angolanized, you know. Now people just don't know if this, the majority of the descendants are Cape Verdeans or Angolans, but a lot of important people in Angola are from Cape Verdean origin, a lot.
So do you feel also, is it a way of trying to establish or show different parallel between what is happening in Lisbon with the Tornados and then with the Cape Verdean in Angola, or it's just something else you wanted to do with that?
It's all of that is part of this crazy mix thing that Portuguese colonization it was. You know, I had another book, my last book indeed. It's about Queen Zingambadi. It's a very famous, you must know, of course.
I've just written the biography of her.
It's an incredible character. It's an incredible character. And at that time, 17th century, the Dutch took a place in Brazil. And they decided to take Luanda also, because the slaves, the slave trader. And so, when they go to Luanda, to take Luanda, they go with a lot of pirates. The chief of the expedition was a very famous Dutch pirate. But they also had Indians, Brazilian Indians, to fight for them. And when we say Portuguese go to take again Luanda, this Portuguese expedition was composed by black Brazilians and Indian Brazilians. And so you had fighting in Angola for the Portuguese king, very remote, distant king. You have Indian, Brazilian Indians and black Brazilians. That's completely crazy, you know? And maybe these Brazilian Indians have descendants in Angola also until now, you know? So all this, you can find all this kind of people in Angola. You have Angolans of Indian ascendants and of Indian, from India, from Goa also, and from Cabo Verde, and from Guinea, and from Mozambique, and etc.
So then how should we think of the Portuguese? Are they a European people? Are they Latin American, African? Who are the Portuguese? How can we, who kind of in an America where we think in racial terms, you're black or white, you know, you're Indian.
Maybe they are just Portuguese.
Can you elaborate? What is a Portuguese, just Portuguese? What has been just Portuguese?
I think a Portuguese is the mix of all this kind of thing, all these people, you know. That's why it's so difficult when you discuss race in America and you take the Latin Americans. Mm-hmm. Why a Latin American is not black in America? I don't understand. I never understood that. Because he is black in Cuba, he's not black in America. I can't understand that. You have so special thing in this kind of race. It's just... but in Angola also we have some things that we can't explain outside. It's very hard to explain. It's like that.
Okay, I see that. Yes.
So, am I allowed? Okay. So, I'm a historian of the deeper past of Angola. And I was very curious when I first went to Luanda, with the almost complete absence in the city of people speaking vernacular African languages. Mm-hmm. And it so happened I went there for a conference in 1997. That's when garbage was this deep on the streets, maybe you remember that time. And so I wasn't aware of the issue of African vernacularism, so I was giving a presentation on the oral traditions of the Kingdom of Congo. And I thought it would be a good idea just to sort of say, Tondele Bene, Muna Bao, Yon Peni, Vova Muna Mtsia Congo. And when I said this in Kikongo, a great stir went out over the audience. Like, people started being very excited. And little did I realize that, as you, and that, you know, the Congos very proud of keeping their language, whereas the Kimbundus lost their language.
Yes,
and so these people were saying, hey, this foreigner here, he speaks an African language, and you don't.
Well,
and
now
I mean, it's very interesting to me, even now, we went to Masangano. We go along the road, this is a rural area, there's children playing in the dirt, and they're speaking to each other in Portuguese.
Yeah. Well, it's a disaster indeed, because we are lost in all the African language. You know, the last census?
Census, yes.
We had now a census, 40 years after the independence.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I don't know if you have the results of this census, but it's very recent, and it's about the language. It's incredible because they say that now 70% of people just speak Portuguese. 70. It's incredible height number. You know, any other country of Africa is like that. But Angola is the only country in Africa where the president just speaks Portuguese, just speaks a colonial language. The only one, I think.
But we have to remember that long history that you talk about.
Well, yes, that's it. You can suggest. I had this discussion recently in German because people say, oh, that's a disaster because you are lost in the language.
Yeah.
That's a disaster. But of course, people have the right to speak Portuguese, you know, it's not all. We have all a culture in music, in everything, literature, in Portuguese, and this Portuguese is an Angolan Portuguese, so it's part of Angola also. You know, it's not. It's just part of Angola.
In 1800 or even 1820, the city council of Luanda kept its meetings in Kimbundu.
Yeah,
even the Portuguese spoke Kimbundu at that point.
Yeah, yeah, no,
so
you
this is a very
two,
recent development.
In 19th century, you had two newspapers wrote in Kimbundu. Okay, and even the others Portuguese have a lot of pieces in Kimbundu also, Portuguese and Kimbundu. And in the poetry, you have the people, old people, Angolans and Portuguese, writing poetry that have some lines in Kimbundu and other lines in Portuguese. You don't have this now. If you want to found a newspaper in Kimbundu now in Luanda, everybody laugh. It's impossible, nobody understands you. So it's a problem, but not just with Kimbundu now. These days, all the languages, the African languages are in crisis. Well, of course, Kikongo is much more strong, and Umbundu also. Umbundu is the biggest.
Yes.
Okay? But even the Umbundu is declining.
So then I could ask you then, instead of saying what are they, who are the Portuguese who returned to Portugal, who are the Angolans who are now 70% speaking Portuguese? Who are the Angolans? Are they a European nation? Are they a Luso nation? Are they an African people?
I think Africa is a very complex and a very rich continent with very different realities. You have Angola, you go to Namibia, it's a completely different country. It's much more different than in Europe. If you go in Europe, if you cross Europe these days, all countries are more or less the same. I'm not such big difference. But in Africa, it's not like that. Countries are very different from each other, and in the same countries, you have also different realities. If you go to South Africa, Durban is the same, Cape Town is another place, completely different in cultural terms. And in Angola, it's also like that. You have Angola, there's a lot of different peoples living in Angola, and one of these people speak Portuguese as a mother tongue. That's what we have in Angola. And you have other people speaking other language, I think the challenge is to give attention to all these people. I mean, the big mistake is just to have these people that speak Portuguese as a mother tongue in power and with all the power. That it's of course very dangerous. And it's a great historical mistake, but it's what we have now.
So I'm now left to thinking, oh my gosh, where does Angola go? Where is nationalism? Where is it going to be a Portuguese nationalism? Is it going to be because the government in power have in fact, you know, used history to shape the type of nation that they want to project. And that history is a history of resistance against Portuguese, against Portuguese colonialism. So how do we balance what this nation is? Is it a nation in itself, or is nation still in formation? And because you are you lived in Angola, you were born in Angola, so you feel that much better than I as a scholar can. So can you tell me, as I'm thinking through this, now I have to rethink my notions of what I tell my students about modern nationalism in Africa, using Angola as a case study.
Yeah, yeah, I understand. But I don't think at that moment nation is in Angola as a nation is an independent country for 40 years. Mm-hmm. There's nothing that can change that, okay. I think, okay? So that's why Angola can go to Portugal and buy everything in Portugal, you know? And the Minister of Justice of Portugal is Angolan, mm-hmm. a black Angolan, mm-hmm. and from a very important Angolan
family. Yes.
So Angola is an independent country, that's not in question, you know, it's an independent country. But as America, you have different peoples living there, and a lot of different peoples living there. And everybody has the right to be Angolan in his own way. As in America, you have a lot of different peoples living here, and talking and speaking different language. You have Americans that speak Spanish, okay, or Indian language or whatever, and they are Americans in their own way. You have not just one way to be Angolan, and thanks God you have not. You have different ways as to be American, not just one way to be American.
So then Angola is more a sort of, you know, its birth and its continuing sort of transformation is more informed by if we understand how American nations emerge than if we are looking at just an African nation. Are you suggesting that this is the way we should look at it? Because in the Americas we had people coming in and transforming.
But in Angola you had also this.
Yes, so I'm saying it more represents an American type.
It was not so different, you know, because you have people, and this is the story of the world, you know, people that come from outside. Even in Angola, you have people that come from North Africa and goes there, you know, and take out other people. The original people was the Bushmen, the Khoisan, and now you have people from all parts of Africa. That's the world. It's not. I think it's not a special case. You know. I think it's the history of the world, just like that.
Okay. Well, I have to thank you so much for sort of bearing with me and my sort of trying to understand Angola through your, you know, the images and the creations that I'm, as a historian, I'm saying, okay, where are the things? Where are my dates? Where are my facts? And you've brought me into a world that I would not have entered. And I thank you very much for it, and we thank you.